Hello, everybody. We're going to talk really quickly about our Martin Luther King STEAM journal. So I'm going to go ahead and grab the real quick. Right, so we have this STEAM journal that was sent home with you. And it says, "Dear students, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. gave many important speeches throughout his lifetime. In those speeches, he talked about many important words. Your challenge is to choose one of Dr. King's big words and make it fit on a piece of graph paper. You will have 10 to 20 minutes to plan your design. You'll actually have as much time as you need to at home. After you plan, you're going to work on the size of your word and how it relates to Dr. Martin Luther King and what he stood for." Okay, so you will need some crayons, markers, or colored pencils. You might want a ruler possibly, but you don't have to. So the first part says, ask, what is the problem you're trying to solve? Imagine the best way to solve the problem on your own. Sketch out your design and brainstorm a list of ideas. How will you use your materials? So this can be an area to help you start thinking about what you want to do. And then this can be a page to just kind of sketch out your plan. It doesn't have to be the one you use. It can just be a practice one. There's one with smaller blocks, or you can do the bigger one, whichever one you choose. This is just the planning stage. It's where you're practicing. I would suggest doing that in pencil. So the next stage is to create. You're going to draw your word. Experiment, find the area and perimeter of your word, improve. How could you do, what could you do to improve your design? You can write down some notes for yourself. Okay, so you're going to ask, what is my idea? What is it possibly going to look like? What's the plan on what I'm going to do? How can I improve it? Or excuse me, how can I create it? I'm going to try some different things and then I'm going to improve it and have a final project. So this is the part where you will find how big your letters are, how much space they take. We haven't talked about area yet, but we've been talking about perimeter, where we measure how big it is on the outside. So you could put your different letters here and just how big the perimeter is. We haven't talked about area yet, so I'm not expecting that. But that's just if you'd like to try that. And then write about how your word relates to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So you can write that on the back of your final project. You can practice it. What's your topic sentence, like what word you're going to pick? So if I was going to do it, if my word is kindness, I could say, I chose the word kindness after Martin Luther King Jr.'s, it's the MLK, story of big words. I think kindness is important to everyone and everything. Okay, so that can be my topic sentence. And then my first supporting detail, treating people the way you want to be treated. Called the golden rule, because it is the most important rule to remember about how you treat people. How you should treat everyone. So my next detail might be kindness is important for animals. You need to be kind to them and respect their habitat because where they live is important for them. All right, let me see if I can turn the light down. Maybe I don't have to see it there. There we go. Okay, so then my last supporting detail might be, how kindness was an important message. Martin Luther King Jr. taught we all want to be treated kindly. Okay. So that might be what I write. Okay. I've got my sentences. So then when I'm done, I might want to, I might even change it and make it better. I just sketched it really fast. So here's where I would write my story, put my sentences here. I can draw a picture. You could also write it on this one that has more lines to write. And there's more lines here for you to write. So you can write it there. Sorry, I forgot that I put those in there. I was going to say write it on the back of your picture, but actually it'd be better to write it out on your paper here. All right, so then we have several different sheets. We have some with the tiny blocks. We have some with the big blocks. And there's several copies in here. So you can practice. You can practice a couple of times. The last copy, whichever one you choose, this one or this one, that's the one you're going to turn in to me. And then you're finished with that. Okay, so you want to be thinking about how much room it's going to take. And then when you're counting up how big it is, you count how many blocks the letters are on. So my word that I would pick would need to go kind of sideways because it's a long one. So if I did graph letters. I might be able to do it sideways. I don't know that I can do it straight because I don't know if it'd be long, it would be wide enough. But once I get my sketch, I can also draw, different things around it. Maybe I draw animals, flowers, people. And then we're going to color it in. We want it to be a beautiful word and color it all in. So where does all of this come from? Where does this idea of Martin's big words come from? I have some videos to share with you. Let's go back to our other screen. Okay. Okay, so we're going to listen to this one first.
That's where he gave his biggest speech. Dear Tim and Moby, can you do a Martin Luther King movie? Thanks, Amari. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was one of the most important leaders of the American Civil Rights Movement. That was the effort to extend equal rights to all people, regardless of race. Well, in the first half of the 20th century, that was a controversial idea. In many parts of the country, African Americans were barred from participating in ordinary life. They couldn't eat at the same lunch tables, go to the same schools, or even use the same bathrooms as white people. This practice of separating African Americans from white people was called segregation. In the South, segregation was enforced through Jim Crow laws. They made it illegal for African Americans to mix with whites. They policed black behavior, too. African Americans had to live in separate neighborhoods, hold specific jobs, and talk to whites with the utmost respect. Try to fight it, and you risk jail time, injury, even death. There were no Jim Crow laws up north, but unspoken rules still kept African Americans apart. In many places, white homeowners would only sell their houses to other white people. These informal codes ensured that African Americans remained second-class citizens. Martin Luther King grew up in the midst of all that inequality. He was born in 1929 to a middle-class family in Atlanta, Georgia. Both his grandfather and his father were pastors at a local church. King attended religious colleges up north, in Philadelphia and Boston. He noticed black and white people mixing more freely than he'd seen growing up. Though these cities had their share of racial tension, they were a far cry from the way things were down south. Dr. King moved to Montgomery, Alabama with his wife, Coretta, in 1953. He became a pastor and community leader. Around that time, a local woman named Rosa Parks was arrested for refusing to give her bus seat to a white man. King joined forces with activist Joanne Robinson to organize a massive boycott of the Montgomery bus system. Most black citizens in Montgomery refused to ride the buses for over a year. Many were violently attacked just for walking instead of taking a bus. Dr. King's house was bombed, and along with dozens of other protesters, he was thrown in jail. But these injustices drew national attention to the issue. And in 1956, a Supreme Court decision banned segregated buses. After that victory, King helped organize a group of churches dedicated to nonviolent protests for civil rights. He was inspired by the life of Mahatma Gandhi, whose nonviolent leadership helped free India from British rule. Over the next decade, King led protests and marches all over the country. The biggest was the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom in 1963. Hundreds of thousands of people gathered in the nation's capital to support civil rights. It was there that Dr. King delivered his momentous I Have a Dream speech.
One day right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today.
Yeah, kind of gives you goosebumps, doesn't it? King's gift for public speaking helped inspire millions of people. His words gave him the hope and courage to believe in the future he envisioned. 2 years later, the protests he led throughout Alabama caught the world's attention. People watched in shock as local police turned fire hoses and attack dogs on peaceful protesters. Well, people often feel threatened by change. In fact, making folks uncomfortable was kind of the point of all this protesting. In a letter written from an Alabama jail, King said, "Nonviolent direct action seeks to create such a crisis and establish such creative tension that a community that has constantly refused to negotiate is forced to confront the issue." In other words, things change only when conditions are made so stressful, people demand it. Oh yeah, King was arrested lots of times during these marches, but the result was worth it. His work pressured Congress to pass groundbreaking laws, moving society closer to his vision. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965 overturned segregation laws around the country. In 1964, he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. He went on to fight against poverty and the Vietnam War. Then in 1968, Martin Luther King was assassinated in Memphis, Tennessee. His killer, James Earl Ray, was captured months later. King was only 39 years old. But in his short life, he changed the face of this country. Without his influence, who knows how long it would have been before equal rights were protected for everyone. Yeah, you're right. We still struggle with racial equality to this day. But thanks to Dr. King and other civil rights leaders, we know that great change is possible.
I have a dream today.
All right. Okay, these are Martin's big words. So this is where our idea is coming from, for our picture.
Cities and towns in the United States. Every time Martin read the words, he felt bad. Until he remembered what his mother told him. You are as good as anyone. In church, Martin sang hymns. Read from the Bible, listened to his father preach. These words made him feel good. When I grow up, I want to get big words too.
Sang with them and prayed with them until the whites
black people who had the courage to stand up for their rights. In the next 10 years, black Americans all over the South protested for equal rights. Martin walked with them and talked with them and sang with them and prayed with them. White ministers told them to stop. Mayors and governors and police chiefs and judges ordered them to stop. But they kept on marching. Wait. For years I have heard the word wait. We have waited more than 340 years for our rights. They were jailed and beaten and murdered. But they kept on marching. Some black Americans wanted to fight back with their fists. Martin convinced them not to, by reminding them of the power of love. Love is the key to the problems of the world. Many white Southerners hated and feared Martin's words. A few threatened to kill him and his family. His house was bombed. His brother's house was bombed. But he refused to stop. Remember, if I am stopped, this movement will not be stopped. Because God is with this movement. The marches continue. More and more Americans listened to Martin's words, shared his dreams, and filled them with hope.
I have a dream
that one day in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers.
I have a dream for me.
After 10 years of protests, the lawmakers in Washington voted to end segregation. The white-only signs in the South came down. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. cared about all Americans. He cared about people all over the world. And people all over the world admired him. In 1964, he won the Nobel Peace Prize. He won it because he taught others to fight with words, not fists. Martin went wherever people needed help. In April 1968, he went to Memphis, Tennessee. He went to help garbage collectors who were on strike. He walked with them and talked with them and sang with them and prayed with them. On his second day there, he was shot. His big words are alive for us today.
I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream. One day, this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its dream. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owner. Will they be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood? I have a dream that one day right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today.
Okay. There we are. Okay. So think about what word would mean something to you, and try to tie it to something that maybe you've learned in Martin's Big Words, that book that we just listened to, or the first little brain pop that we just watched at the very beginning. Maybe you have a book you've heard or read about Martin Luther King Jr. So think about that today. Try to come up with a plan on a word that you could make. And after you're done, decorate it and make sure you bring it back. Make sure your name's on it. I'm anxious to see what you guys come up with. It'll be really fun. So, all right, guys, I hope you have a great day. I hope you have fun with this project. And I hope you have a good weekend. And just think about, you know, some of those important words that you heard in that book today. All right, guys. Well, thank you so much for working on some STEM with me today. And I will talk to you guys if you can make it to our 1 o'clock Zoom meeting, that would be fabulous. Otherwise, I will see you guys on Tuesday and Wednesday. All right, guys. Thank you so much.